The scripture for us today is from Isaiah chapter 9. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of deep darkness, a light has dawned. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders. And he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the greatness of his government and peace there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this.
This morning, I want to tell you the story of August Pullman. Augie, as he was called, as he is called, a 10-year-old boy with a rare facial deformity. He's gone through 27 surgeries to repair his hearing, his vision, and his appearance to the extent possible, but he's always going to live with a misshapen face. Augie is the fictional hero of a book for children and youth, New York Times bestseller for 5 years in a row, has received numerous awards, was put into a movie in 2017 by the same title, Wonder, starring Julia Roberts, Owen Wilson, and Jacob Tremblay as Augie. Now, at the risk of spoiling the story, if you ever get to see the movie, I'm going to tell it to you. Now, the movie is lots better than my telling, so not to worry. The movie would still be good when you get your chance. To protect Augie from the shock and stares of people seeing him for the first time, his parents homeschooled him through the fourth grade and kept him home much of the time. And when he did go outside in public, he wore a space helmet. Now, even though this was a little odd, Augie figured it was something a kid would do. And it was not as jolting as people seeing his face for the first time. In the summer before his fifth grade, his parents made an agonizing decision to send him to school, knowing full well how the other students would react. But they knew that Augie needed to come to terms with the real world. Augie also knew how the kids would react, and he did not want to go to school. But eventually, he submitted to what his parents wanted. There's a touching scene when Augie and his parents walk to the school for the first day of class. He's wearing his helmet. He stops at the gate. He takes it off, hands it to his father, and then he squares his shoulders and walks toward the school door as a stunned group of students part in front of him. He wants nothing more than to be considered as a regular kid. But his classmates can't get past his scarred, distorted face. So the students all pull away from Augie, staring and calling him a freak. One boy especially, Julian, and his buddies, is especially mean in sneaky, underhanded ways. All through the year, Augie is bullied and tormented by Julian and his friends. Then one boy, Jack, reaches out to befriend Augie, and they become best friends. Then a girl named Summer chooses to sit with him at the lunch table. One by one, Augie wins over his friends by his courage, determination, and winsomeness. At the end of the year, there's a nature retreat among different schools, and when Augie is threatened by seventh graders from the other school, even Julian's friends come to his defense. By the end of the year, Augie has won over all of his classmates, except for Julian, the bully, who's now the one standing alone. At the final awards assembly, at the end of the year, Augie gets the final and best reward, for kindness, friendship, courage, and character. And he gets a standing ovation by the whole school. On his way home that day, there's this touching exchange between Augie and his mother. Augie hugs his mom and says, "Thank you for making me go to school." She hugs him back and says, "Thank you, Augie." "What for?" he asks. And the mom replies, "For everything you've given us, for coming into our lives, for being you." Then she bends down and whispers, "You really are a wonder, Augie. You are a wonder." That is how Mary felt about her son, Jesus. "Thank you for coming into our lives. Thank you for everything you've given us. Jesus, you are a wonder." In this Advent series, we've been looking at questions that the people in the Advent stories, the birth stories of Jesus, may have asked. And today we get to Mary. And the question that Mary may have asked is the one on the screen. Who is this child? If you think about it, all of us have to answer that question. Who is Jesus? Is he just a fictional character like Augie? Not even an historical person that ever lived? Is he only a good teacher so that we can pick and choose among the things that he said? Or is he, as we read in the Bible, the Son of God? And if so, we must bow at his feet in faith and worship and trust our lives to him. In a spontaneous outpouring of joy and praise, Mary communicates her wonder, her surprise, her amazement, her awe in words that have become one of the great enduring songs of the church. Now, one of my son-in-law is a composer, so I looked this up to find out for sure. These words in the Bible, we're going to read them in a moment, were put to music over 20 centuries by 233 composers in all, including Bach and Mozart. The Song of Mary, called the Magnificat at times, is recorded in Luke 1, 46-55. And if you have your Bibles, turn with me to that passage. Luke 1, 46 to 55. It'll be on the screen too. "And Mary said, 'My soul glorifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has been mindful of the humble state of his servant. From now on, all generations will call me blessed, for the Mighty One has done great things for me. Holy is his name. His mercy extends to those who fear him from generation to generation. He has performed mighty deeds with his arm. He has scattered those who are proud in their inmost thoughts. He has brought down rulers from their thrones, but lifted up the humble. He has filled the hungry with good things, but has sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel, remembering to be merciful to Abraham and his descendants forever, just as he promised our ancestors.'" Now let's look again at these verses in sequence. First, Mary reflects on the great mercy of God to her personally for a totally unprecedented and never repeated honor. Verses 46 to 49, "My soul glorifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has been mindful of the humble state of his servant. From now on, all generations will call me blessed, for the Mighty One has done great things for me. Holy is his name." And after she reflects personally, she sort of widens the lens of her perspective to encompass God's mercy to all humankind, from generation to generation, through the whole of history, back to the beginning of time. Verse 46, she says, no, 50. She says, "He shows mercy from generation to generation to all who fear him." In this prophetic song, the Holy Spirit gives one answer to the question, who is this child? And that is, this child is the ultimate gift of God who never gives up on us. If you think about it, when Adam and Eve disobeyed in the garden, the first man and woman, because they ate the forbidden fruit, God could have given up on humankind right then. Instead, in his great mercy, he immediately shifted to a rescue plan, which culminated many centuries later in this child, in Jesus. Or in the time of Noah, when the Bible describes people as being so very evil and wicked, so much so that God saw their wickedness and was ready to blot humankind off the face of the earth. But again, he relented. His mercy prevailed. He spared Noah and his family from the great flood and continued his plan, his determination to rescue humankind. And then he chose the people of Israel to be his witnesses, his representatives, so the whole world might eventually know. But they failed miserably. Time and time they disobeyed God and worshiped idols and did evil. He waited for centuries, but finally he sent the Babylonian army to conquer Jerusalem and took his people into captivity. But even then, he promised that his rescue work would continue. In the midst of that catastrophe, the prophet Jeremiah said this, "Behold, the days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. I will put my law within them. I will write it on their hearts. I will be their God, and they will be my people, and I will forgive their iniquity, and I will remember their sin no more." In her song, Mary is rejoicing in the great wonder of God's mercy. She knew that his steadfast love never ceases, that his mercies never come to an end. She knew that God was working out his purposes from generation to generation to generation. God did not give up on humankind. He did not give up on Israel. He does not give up on us, on you or on me. Jesus gives us every opportunity to trust him as Savior and Lord, and then as followers of Jesus to grow into his likeness from one degree of glory to another. In his grace, mercy, he will never give up on us. Next in her song, Mary reflects on the unexpected way that God exercises his power. She sings this, verse 51. "He has performed mighty deeds with his arm. He has scattered those who are proud in their inmost thoughts. He has brought down rulers from their thrones, but has lifted up the humble. He has filled the hungry with good things, but he has sent the rich away empty." Most often, when we think of power, we think of kings and presidents and parliaments, or we think of armies and navies, of missiles. We might think of billionaires or of the media that shapes public opinion. But Mary understood God's power to be entirely different. She knew what prophet Isaiah had said, "For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, declare the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts." That is why the people in the early church, as you recall the book of Acts and the letters of the New Testament, were not powerful people. They were not the shakers and the movers in the world of that time. Paul describes the early followers of Jesus this way. "For consider your calling, brothers, not many of you were wise according to worldly standards. Not many were powerful. Not many were of noble birth, but God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. God chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. God chose what is low and despised in the world, even things that are not, to bring to nothing things that are, so that no human being might boast in the presence of God." God works most powerfully in people with humble hearts. Coming back to the question Mary could have asked, who is this child? Mary anticipated in this song the supreme humility that she would see, that the world would see in the birth and life and death of Jesus. Paul, in Philippians 2, 6 to 11, says it this way. Jesus, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. It was the unexpected power of Jesus' humility in his birth, life, and death that moved James Allen Francis, a pastor in Los Angeles, in 1926 to describe the wonder of Jesus in a way that over 90 years since that time, slightly adapted and updated, has become a classic description of Jesus' humility and impact on the world. I expect you're familiar with this, as I am, but I never tire hearing it. Let me read you what that pastor said 90 years ago. He was born in an obscure village as the child of a peasant woman. He grew up in another obscure village. He worked in a carpenter shop until he was 30, and then for 3 years was an itinerant preacher. He never wrote a book. He never held an office. He never owned a home. He never had a family. He never went to college. He never put his foot inside a big city. He never traveled 200 miles from the place where he was born. He never did one of the things that usually accompany greatness. He had no credentials but himself. He had nothing to do with this world except the power of his divine manhood. While still a young man, the tide of popular opinion turned against him. His friends ran away. One of them denied him. Another betrayed him. He was turned over to his enemies. He went through the mockery of a false trial. He was nailed upon the cross between two thieves. His executioners gambled for the only piece of property he had on earth while he was dying, and that was his coat. When he was dead, he was taken down and laid in a borrowed grave through the pity of a friend. 20 wide centuries have come and gone, and today he is the center of the human race and the leader of the column of progress. I am far within the mark when I say that all the armies that have ever marched, all the navies that were ever built, and all the parliaments that have ever sat, and all the kings that have ever reigned, put together, have not affected the life of humankind as powerfully as this one solitary life. There are times that God does work through kings and parliaments and presidents and armies, but his greatest work of all is through Jesus and in and through people with humble hearts, whether it seems like it or not. Those of us who trust Jesus as Savior and Lord and do our best to live for him day in and day out. Another response in this song to the question, who is this child, is that Mary's son Jesus is the culmination of God's promises. Verses 54 to 55, he has helped his servant Israel and remembered to be merciful, for he made this promise to our ancestors, to Abraham and his children forever. Mary's song refers all the way back, at least 1,500 years, to the time of Abraham, when the Lord said to Abraham, go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land I will show you, and I will make you a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great so that you will be a blessing. And that promise went on to further fulfillment in King David, And what the Lord said to him is this: when your days are fulfilled and you lie down with your fathers, I will raise up your offspring after you, who shall come from your body, and I will establish his kingdom. He shall build a house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. And then the promise becomes most explicit in Isaiah: for to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be upon his shoulders, and his name will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. The point here, as it applies to us, is that God is faithful to his promises. What he has said, he will do. For Abraham, for David, for Isaiah, and now because of Jesus, for us. Apostle Paul writes, "For no matter how many promises God has made, they are yes in Jesus." God has promised us, any of us, a great salvation. And when we come to him, he has promised us a great transformation. And when our time comes to leave this earth, he has promised us a great destiny in heaven. All this he will do because of Jesus. Every one of God's promises, as we find them in the Bible, are fulfilled in Jesus. Jesus is the child who stirred such wonder in Mary. When we ask, as Mary has, may have, who is this child? The answers that stir our wonders are these: Jesus will never give up on humankind or any of us as individuals. Jesus worked through, in and through everyone with a humble heart who's willing to trust him. And Jesus fulfills every one of God's promises. All this we remember. We have to take time to do it because we're so busy in this season. But when we pause and take time to think, we can remember the wonder of who Jesus is. Let's pray. Jesus, thank you for coming into this world. Thank you for coming into our lives. Thank you for everything that you've done for us, for everything you will do. Truly, Jesus, you are a wonder. I pray that you will help us to know that you're not just a story, not just fiction like Augie, a real person who came to earth, who lived, who died, who suffered, who rose again. And now because you're risen, lives with us forever. God with us, Emmanuel. I pray that in these coming days, we will sense that more deeply than we ever have before. Some of us right now, Lord God, are going through trials, sickness, illness, hospitalization. As Tim said at the beginning of the service, not everyone can celebrate because there are shadows and hardships that they're going through. But I pray, Lord Jesus, whatever our circumstances, that we will wonder at you, at your mercy. You never give up. At your power expressed so differently in humble hearts and in your promises, which you will fulfill, every one for all who ask. All this, Jesus, we ask in your name and give you thanks. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Pastor Warren. God does not give up on us. And he works in our humble hearts, and he fulfills his promises. I love that Jesus is the child who stirred wonder in Mary and in all of us.